We began looking at the subject of suffering this past Wednesday night. We'd like to ask and pray that God will help us as we continue that study. If you have your Bibles this morning, I would ask you to please turn to 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2. We'd like to begin reading with verse 19, read through verse 24. Beginning 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 19, the Word of God says, "For this is thankworthy, if a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrongfully. For what glory is it if, when ye be buffeted for your faults, ye shall take it patiently? But if when ye do well and suffer for it, ye take it patiently, this is acceptable with God. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps, who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth, who when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously." The last expression tells us that when Jesus suffered, didn't matter what kind of suffering it was, didn't matter whether it was people turning their backs on him, like all the apostles forsook him and fled, or whether it was suffering because of physical persecution, where he would be beaten and he would be put in bonds and he would be nailed to the cross of Calvary. All the sufferings that Jesus went through, he did not retaliate anybody that did him wrong. Rather, the Word of God says that he committed himself to God that judgeth righteously. There's a verse that should immediately come to your mind when we state that. Can anybody think of the verse? "Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord." And I pray that God will help every one of us here to understand that we are not to retaliate or try to get even with those who treat us wrong. It's very important that we exercise our faith when we have been mistreated by someone. They have hurt us, whether it's physically, emotionally, however it is they've hurt us. We need to commit it all to God, who judgeth righteously. God will take care of everything. "And vengeance is God, saith the Lord." The most important thing I want us to look at this morning is not retaliation or getting even, but rather the important lesson that we need to learn is that God has given every one of us the ability to suffer, and he's given us the responsibility to suffer for doing well. Now, if we do wrong and suffer for it, there's no blessing from God. When we do wrong and we suffer for it, the suffering is usually going to come from God. But if we do well, if we do what's right, if we do what's good, and we suffer for that, that suffering is going to come from men. And who will comfort you when you do what's right and you suffer for doing what's right? Or when you do what's good and you suffer for that, who will comfort you when you suffer for righteousness' sake? Jesus, our Lord. God will always comfort and bless you and help you and reward you. He will bless your life when you're willing to suffer for Christ's sake. So the Word of God says here in verse 19, "This is thankworthy, if a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrongfully." You know what happens to me sometimes when I suffer wrongfully, when I've done good and I suffer for it? Sometimes I want to tell somebody else about it. I want to justify myself. I want to try to tell everybody what happened to me. Woe is me. Look at how I suffered for doing what's right. Well, I want you to know that just as when we give gifts to be seen of men, likewise when we suffer and we want everybody to feel sorry for us, then our reward comes from men and not from God. When I suffer for well-doing, I need to be willing to take it patiently. That is, don't be telling other people. Don't be crying on everybody's shoulder. Whenever you do well and suffer for it, then you keep that to yourself and you take it patiently and you trust in God, knowing that God will repay. I will, God says, I will repay, saith the Lord. Now come with me to 1 Peter chapter 3. He continues, Peter writes more about suffering than any other writer. He does it in a lot of different ways, but in 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 17, Peter says, it is better, if the will of God be so, that ye suffer for what?
Well-doing.
It is better, if the will of God be so, that ye suffer for well-doing than for evil-doing. And I want to again remind you that when we are suffering for evil-doing, then that's going to be the chastening hand of God. And do you know who can help you when God's chastening you? Do you know who can comfort you? Do you know who can relieve pressure whenever you're suffering at God's hand? Nobody can help you when God is bringing the judgment. On the other hand, when you're suffering for well-doing rather than for evil-doing, God is always going to be there. And God is always able to help you and comfort you and bless you to feel the peace of God that passeth all understanding. So Peter says here in 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 17, it is better, if the will of God be so, that ye suffer for well-doing than for evil-doing. Now come down to chapter 4 and verse 1. 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 1. The Word of God says, for as much then as Christ hath suffered for us in the flesh. Do you see what Peter does in 1 Peter chapter 2? He says, Christ suffered for us, leaving us an example. And now he again comes back to Christ, and he says, for as much then as Christ hath suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same mind. Now, what mind is that? It's the mind of Christ, but it's arming yourself with the same mind that I know and understand if I'm going to walk in a godly way, I know I'm going to suffer for well-doing. Let me tell you something. All suffering is a result of one of three different things. Every time you suffer, you're either going to be suffering for well-doing, or you're going to be suffering for evil doing, or you're going to be suffering as a trial of your faith. All suffering either comes from well doing, from evil doing, or as a trial of your faith. And the Word of God here tells us in 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 1 that we need to arm ourselves with the mind of Christ, that as Jesus committed everything to the Father's hands, and Jesus left all judgment of men for their mistreatment of Him, He left all that in the hand of the Father. I need to arm myself with the same mind, that I understand I'm wanting to suffer, I'm willing to suffer, and I count it all joy that I have the privilege to suffer for my Lord and my Savior. It's a privilege and a blessing to suffer for Christ's sake. And to commit yourself unto God, who judgeth righteously in all things. So arm yourselves with the same mind, for he that hath suffered in the flesh hath ceased from sin. Now come down to verse 12. 1 Peter chapter 4. And verse 12, what do you think he's going to be talking about in verse 12? He's going to be talking about suffering. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12, he says, Beloved, Think it not strange concerning the, what are the next two words there? The fiery trial. The fiery trial. I mentioned a while ago that all suffering is either a result of well-doing, a result of evil-doing, or a trial of your faith. Now I want you to think of somebody in the Bible that you know suffered as a trial of his faith. Who do you know suffered as a trial of his faith? Job did, and many others, but Job is one of the first men that comes to our minds. And who is it that was bringing all that suffering into the life of Job? It was the devil. And the devil will bring suffering into your lives, and you will have sicknesses and problems and trouble and financial problems, and you're going to have family problems, and you're going to have all of the kinds of trouble in your life. You're going to have fiery trials, and those fiery trials are coming from the devil. And as the devil is trying you, and there's a sense in which God is trying your faith, but as the devil is the one that's bringing those fiery trials, then you need to always be looking to Jesus and asking Jesus to help you. It doesn't say here in 1 Peter 4:12, it doesn't say fiery trials may come. It doesn't say they might come. It doesn't say they come to the lives of some of God's children. But Peter says, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you. You will have fiery trials. And when they come, you need to pray, Jesus, help me. Help me to suffer through this fiery trial in a way that you would handle this fiery trial. Help me to know what to do. Help me to know what to say. Help me to know what not to say. But help me in this fiery trial. And then he finishes this verse and says, beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you as though some strange thing happened unto you. But rejoice inasmuch as ye are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy. I'll tell you, brethren, there are a lot of different times that Jesus' glory is revealed. And when he reveals his glory, you're going to be comforted. One of the times that Jesus reveals his glory is after a child of God has been going through suffering. And Jesus has not been revealing his glory like in the life of Job. And Job said, I know God's working on the left hand and the right hand, but I can't find him. God was there. Job knew God was there, but Jesus had not revealed his glory. But I'll tell you, brethren, when Jesus began, God began to reveal his glory. Then Job said, I've heard of you by the hearing of the ear, but now mine eye seeth thee. I'll tell you, if you, when you're in the midst of fiery trials and suffering, if you keep waiting on the Lord and trusting in God, God is going to manifest himself in an exceeding way. And when he does that, you're going to see the glory of God. You're going to feel the presence and the power and the peace of God. And the only people that ever feel and see that glory, are those that are willing to suffer for Christ's sake. Brethren, you're going to suffer if you stand up for what's right. And most people don't know about suffering for doing what's right. They know about suffering for doing what's wrong. And they know about suffering as a child of their faith, but that most people don't know about suffering for doing what's right. God's word is very important. And there's some hard sayings in God's word. And a lot of people don't want to have God's word. A lot of people, in fact, in John chapter 6, the word of God says that many of his disciples turned back and walked no more with him. You know what I feel every time somebody turns back and walks no more with us? Suffering, weeping, sorrow. It's sad. Why did those disciples turn back and walk no more with him? The word of God says because of the hardness of his sayings. And that causes people not to despise Jesus so much if you're taking the stand. They despise you for taking the stand. And they don't see it as Jesus or the Word of God that they're standing against. They see it as you that they're standing against. You're the problem. You're the trouble. And so they hate you. And you have to be willing to suffer when you stand up for what God's Word has to say. Verse 13 says, "But rejoice, inasmuch as ye are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy." You get to experience that exceeding joy when you endure the suffering. Verse 14 says, "If ye be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye, for the Spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you." When does the Spirit of glory and of God rest upon you? When does that happen? When you're suffering for Christ's sake. On their behalf he is evil spoken of, but on your part he is glorified. But let none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or as a busybody in other men's matters. Yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf. Glorify God when you're suffering. Give God the glory. Didn't the apostles do that when they were beaten? They rejoiced and gave God the glory. And thank God that they were counted worthy to be a partaker of his sufferings. Back up 10 pages. Back up about 10 pages in your Bible to Hebrews chapter 11. About 10 pages before where we're reading. And Hebrews, look at Hebrews chapter 11. We've been looking at 1 Peter, but now look at back up 10 pages to Hebrews chapter 11. I want you to think about Moses. Now, before we think about Moses, let me ask you, did Peter suffer?
Yeah.
Yes, he did. A tricky question I'm fixing to ask you now, so listen carefully. Did Peter suffer for well-doing, or did Peter suffer for evil-doing, or did Peter suffer as a trial of his faith? All three. That's exactly right. He always was willing to suffer for well-doing. Not always. One time he wasn't willing to suffer for well-doing. He wasn't willing to identify himself as a Christian when Jesus was about to be crucified. He denied Christ. And then he suffered for that, didn't he? He suffered for evil-doing. But we know he suffered for well-doing, and he suffered as a trial of his faith. Moses suffered for well-doing. Look in your Bibles at Hebrews chapter 11 as the Word of God. In fact, everybody in Hebrews chapter 11, every single person in Hebrews 11 that walked by faith and lived by faith, they all suffered for well-doing. Did Abraham suffer for well-doing?
Yeah.
Did Noah suffer for well-doing?
Yeah.
Did Moses suffer for well-doing? Did Abraham suffer for well-doing? Come with me to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 23. "By faith Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months." Now whose faith was that? What, Moses' faith? Whose faith was it? It was his parents' faith. "When he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents, because they saw he was a proper child, and they were not afraid of the king's commandment." Now, if you're not afraid of the king's commandment, that means you're going to have to be willing to what? You're going to have to be willing to suffer at the hand of the king. You have to be willing to suffer at the hand of the king. There are people in authority, and if you're not going to obey their authority, if you acknowledge God as your authority, and you're going to follow God, you have to be unafraid of those under God. And if you fear these people and do what they say instead of what God says, you fear those people more than you fear God. And so when Pharaoh said that those babies were to be killed, the parents of Moses had faith in God, and they were not afraid And they hid Moses, and they put him in that basket, and he went down the river, and Mary followed him there, and who found Moses in that little basket? Pharaoh's daughter. Boy, he hit the jackpot, didn't he? And then they needed somebody for the baby to nurse on. And here's this Hebrew woman standing right over here, close by, who was Moses' mother. And they say, would you come nurse this baby? Wow. You know what was being revealed? The glory of God. The power of God was being revealed. You think she suffered? She suffered. She put her baby in that basket. She wasn't positive what the outcome was. She didn't know what was going to happen. But she wasn't going to slay her baby. Wasn't going to let them slay her baby. Then she'd rather put it in the basket and see what happens. Come down to verse 24 now. By faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Oh, now he's going to suffer, isn't he? When you refuse to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. By faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. I'm going to ask you a question. Can sin bring some pleasure in your life? Yes. All sin will definitely bring pain in your life. But sin, for a season, temporarily, you can find some pleasure in sin. But a person that has wisdom understands, I'm a child of God. God's not going to let me continue to enjoy sin. I may enjoy sin for a short season, but God's going to bring His judgment. And when God brings His judgment, that's the end of me enjoying sin. And I'll tell you, every time God brings His judgment, every child of God will tell you the suffering they experience when God brings His judgment is far greater than whatever the joy was they were getting out of the sin. There is no joy worth the suffering you have to experience for doing what's wrong. So he chose to suffer affliction with the people of God. Let me read verse 27. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Brethren, all of us need to understand that we must endure suffering if we're going to be a Christian. 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 12 says, all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. If you're going to live godly in Christ Jesus, you're going to suffer persecution. If you're not suffering persecution, it is evidence that you are not living like a Christian as much as you should. Because when you live like a Christian, you will suffer. When you stand where God's word says to stand, especially in this evil world in which we live, you're going to suffer as a Christian when you do what's right. Go with me now to Matthew 5. Please turn your Bibles very quickly to Matthew chapter 5. I'm so glad that Jesus told us everything before we started following Him. You see, if I were to stand up here and tell you, walk down this aisle and join the church, and Jesus is going to love you, and you're going to be rich, and you're going to have all the money you want, and you're never going to be sick, and if I were to lie to you and tell you all that trash that some preachers use, you're going to have a sad awakening. Because you beginning to follow Christ, taking up your cross in water baptism, does not mean you're not going to suffer. It is showing that you're willing to suffer for Christ's sake. And if you have not taken up your cross in water baptism, I would encourage you to know and understand you have that responsibility. And I don't care what it takes. I don't care who you have to deny. I don't care what sacrifices you have to make. You all, every person here, needs to take up your cross in water baptism. Follow Jesus. Follow the example he gave us. Follow the command he gave us. Jesus told us preachers, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel, and we're to be baptizing and teaching the word of God. Matthew chapter 5, beginning in verse 10. The word of God says, blessed, here he is now, very beginning of his ministry, the Sermon on the Mount, first sermon that we have any record of him preaching, and he says, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Is that saying you're going to go to heaven when you die, if you're willing to suffer for Christ's sake? Not saying that at all. You're going to heaven when you die because of Jesus' sufferings. But you can enter the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the what? Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And verse 11 he says, blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. How many of you would rather not suffer? Hold up your hand. My goodness, rest of you, I need to talk to y'all later. Something bad wrong. I don't want to suffer. I don't like to suffer. I prefer, you know, some people say, you just don't care if people like you or not. Yes, I do. I would like for everybody in the world to like me. I would. But I know you can't be a Christian and that happens. So I'm reconciled to everybody in the world not liking me. But I want Jesus to manifest his love for me. I want to please Jesus. And I know this one truth. I know that the servant is not greater than his master. And when I look at the life of Jesus Christ and I see how he suffered, then I know the servant is going to have to suffer too. Let's close by looking at John. Look at John chapter 15 and verse 18. John chapter 15 and verse 18. The word of God says, John 15, beginning in verse 18, if the world hate you, know that it hated me before it hated you. Now, I find some comfort in that. Jesus gave us an example. Jesus showed us how to live. Jesus showed us, don't be a friend of the world. Jesus showed us how to suffer. Verse 19 says, if ye were of the world would love his own. But tell you something, brethren, if the world likes you, if the people of the world like you, I'm telling you, you're in big trouble with Jesus. If the world likes you, if the world is comfortable around you, if worldly people living ungodly can be comfortable around you, you are in trouble with Jesus. Everybody understand that? If you keep your mouth shut when you know people are doing things that are ungodly and you don't say anything about it, if you know that they're committing adultery and you don't say anything about it, you're in trouble with God. John chapter 15, if ye were of the world would love his own. But because you're not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. Does the world hate you? If you're a follower of Jesus, it does. And verse 20 says, we'll close right here, remember the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours also. Jesus goes before me everywhere I go. Jesus goes before you everywhere you go. And the world has already decided it hates Jesus. But there's some people out there that do love Jesus. And when you meet them and you come in contact with them and you share the truth of God's word with them, those people who love Jesus are going to love you. And those people who hate Jesus are going to hate you. May God help us to love Jesus and to be willing to suffer for Christ's sake, is my prayer for Christ's sake.